Cūḷa Hatthipadopama Sutta. Cūḷa means smaller. Hatthi means the elephant. Pada is the foot. Upama is simile. The simile of the smaller version of the elephant's footprint. Here it doesn't mean that this elephant has a small footprint. It means the shorter version of the sutta. Because there is another sutta based on the same simile, it is longer than this sutta, so it is called Mahathipadopama Sutta. This one is Cūḷa Hatthipadopama Sutta. Buddha compares this elephant footprint to the signs of his enlightenment, to the signs of nirvana. So, if we continue to explain this, you will find it is explained in this sutta, is explaining the path to the enlightenment, nothing else. Path to the nirvana. So, the background story behind this sutta is that there was a Brahmin, a very powerful Brahmin, Janaswami. He was so powerful and rich. One day, he informed the city of Savatthi, "Today I am traveling in the city." In the commentaries it says, when he is traveling in the city, he travels on a white chariot, harnessed white mares to this chariot, wearing white clothes, white slippers, white hat, white umbrella, and wearing white jewelries, that means silver jewelries. It is explained that he is like a living Brahma. He is traveling in this white chariot in the city of Savatthi. People who are about to go out of the city waits to see this. People who are out of the city come into the city to see this spectacular sight of this Janaswami traveling in the city. It doesn't happen so often. It is a rare incident for them, rare scene for them to see. So it is kind of a spectacular sight for everybody in the city. But those days it happened that way. Yeah, they had these chariots with the horses, so they had decorated to kind of demonstrate kind of exhibition to the city, to the people, to show that how powerful and rich they are. Yeah, I have seen some people, they decorate their vehicles with gold, sometimes with silver, sometimes to show off, to show that how rich they are to the world. Likewise, this Janaswami was doing that. So after this traveling in the city, he was coming out of the city. When he was coming out of the city, he met a Parivrajaka, a traveler, a wanderer called Pilotika. He is coming back after visiting and serving the Buddha. Right? This Pilotika is coming back. When he saw the Pilotika, this Janusoni, addressed by his clan name, that is Vachayana. He addressed this Pilotika by his clan name, Vachayana, asking, "Now where is Master Vachayana coming from in the middle of the day?" Vachayana says, "Sir, I am coming from the presence of the recluse Gautama." Now, others who are not the students of the Buddha usually addressed him as recluse Gautama. For them, he is another recluse, not much different. Then Janusoni asks, "What does Master Vachayana think of the recluse Gautama's lucidity of wisdom? He is wise, is he not? Now, there must be the rumors, or the words must have spread about the wisdom of the Buddha. So Janusoni must have heard about the wisdom of the Buddha. So he is asking Vachayana, because Janusoni have never met, he has never met Buddha. He is asking Vachayana, or this Pilotika, the wanderer, what do you think about his wisdom?" Then Pilotika says, "Who am I to explain his wisdom? Only another Buddha can explain the wisdom of him. Only a person who is in the same standard as the recluse Gautama, or as the Buddha himself, can explain the wisdom of the Buddha." Then Janusoni says, "You are extremely praising, complimenting this Master Gautama or the ascetic Gautama." Then Vachayana says, "Who am I to complain? Who am I to praise, compliment the ascetic Gautama? A person who is in his level only, a person who is in the level of the ascetic Gautama or the Buddha can compliment him." Then, now this is in the middle of the road. Sitting on the chariot, Janusoni, standing on the ground, the Pilotika. Now Janusoni is very curious. This is a man of another religion. This is not a Buddhist monk. This is not a Buddha's disciple. A man of another religion, praising, complimenting the ascetic Gautama in such a way. This is something very surprising thing. Right? Then Janusoni asks, "Why are you complimenting in such a manner? What is the reason for you to be happy with the ascetic Gautama this much?" Then Vachayana says, he gives this example. He says, "Suppose a wise elephant woodsman were to enter an elephant wood and were to see in the elephant wood a big elephant's footprint, long in extent and broad across. he would come to the conclusion, this carpenter enters to this particular forest where it is said to be herds of elephants are gathered up. Usually number of elephants living in this forest. And when he see a very big, long in extent, broad across, that means a large footprint of an elephant, he would come to the conclusion, he will decide, indeed this is a big bull elephant. Remember this term, throughout the discourse this term is coming in, big bull elephant. Big we know, bull we know, elephant we know. Concluded, that means he is the king of the elephants. King of the elephants. In strength and in size, no other elephant is compared to this big bull elephant. So too, now when he saw this big footprint of an elephant, he decided this footprint must belong to a big bull elephant. Okay, so too when I saw four footprints of the recluse Gautama, I came to the conclusion, the Blessed One is fully enlightened, the Dhamma is well proclaimed by the Blessed One, the Sangha is practicing the good way. What are the four? Now he is talking about four groups of learned people. These four groups of learned people are the learned nobles, learned Brahmins, learned householders, learned recluses. Learned nobles, learned Brahmins, learned householders, learned recluses. Who must be these learned nobles? Kshatriyas, kings. Yeah. So he says these four groups of learned people, learned nobles, learned Brahmins. You know Brahmins. Even in India, there are these Brahmins today, yeah, who are doing all those pujas for the gods. Yeah, they are the one who by heart the Vedas. These are the learned Brahmins. Then comes the learned householders. There are, you know, just householders are the people like you, the people who has houses, householder, holding houses, right? Who has houses. Then comes the learned recluses, other religious people. These people, now those days, the people who can argue and compete with others with the arguments, you know, not only argue with others and defeat others with the arguments, and if somebody can defeat all the religious masters, all the people who is considered to be clever and became the number one person who can never be defeated by arguments, that person is respected, venerated, even better than a king. This is an age, this is an era where the intelligence was valued, where the wisdom was valued, not the wealth itself, not the money itself. India was super rich at that time. Now today the India is a very poor country, but India was not poor all the time. India was very rich at that time. It was a very rich country. So they are rich by birth, They do not want to look for money, look for wealth. What do they look for is the knowledge. Knowledge to what? To argue with others. And to defeat others and to become powerful. Nobody even come closer to that person. Everybody respects that person. People become powerful in that way at that time. So these learned Brahmins, learned nobles, learned Brahmins, learned householders, then learned recluses, ascetics. These people, now this is how they explain. I have seen here certain learned nobles, the first group, who were clever, knowledgeable about the doctrines of others. They learn others' doctrines. As sharp as hair-splitting marksmen. Who are these hair-splitting marksmen? Right? Hair-splitting marksmen is, there are archers who can shoot in such a accuracy that he can split your hair, one single hair, with this arrow. Such an accurate shooting can be done by these people. Yeah? So hair-splitting marksmen are those people. Of course, he cannot shoot and split my hair, and some of us, some of my group people, yeah, cannot, but others, careful, they can. These are the hair-splitting marksmen. Such an accuracy is there. They are, that to indicate their intelligence is that sharp. Their intelligence is that sharp. Yeah. They wonder about, now once they are educated, once they are learned, they are not going for jobs, they are not going for teaching or something. What do they do? Wonder about. Now, those days, the system is that you carry a branch of a tree, and that branch of a tree you carry and you stick it to a heap of sand in the middle of a city and you pronounce it or you stay there. That means you are inviting people to argue, inviting people to come and argue with you. That's what they were doing. So they were wonder about. That's how they defeat others. Intelligent defeat. Arguing defeat with arguments. Yeah. Wonder about, as it were, demolishing the views of others with their sharp wits. When they hear the recluse Gautama will visit such and such a village or town, now this is what they do. Very interesting. They formulate a question. Thus, we will go to the recluse Gautama and ask him this question. If he is asked like this, he will answer like this. And so we will refute, we will challenge his doctrine in this way. If he answers this way, we will challenge him this way. And if he is asked like that, he will answer like that. And so we will refute his doctrine in that way. You see, they are planning what is the question to ask. If we ask this way, he will answer this way. Then we will challenge him this way, another way. Like that, they are planning their arguments, these four groups. Okay? They hear. Now, they go to the recluse Gautama, and the recluse Gautama instructs, urges, rouses, and gladdens them with the talk on the Dhamma. Buddha is not ready to argue, right? He just teaches the Dhamma, and make them happy with the Dhamma. After they have been instructed, urged, roused and gladdened by the recluse Gautama with a talk on the Dhamma, they do not so much as ask him the question, so how should they refute his doctrine? After they listen to the Buddha, they even do not go to ask him questions. How can they challenge him if they even cannot ask the questions? Now this is the challenge for anyone who goes to the Buddha, because you cannot go with him with the predetermined concepts, ideas, challenges. He is very unpredictable. Buddha is very unpredictable. Now there is a Zen story. One boy coming from the Zen temple, another boy coming from another religious place. The one who came from another religious place asked the boy who came from Zen temple, where are you going? I am going to the direction where the wind is blowing. Now this boy who came from other religious place, he was very confused. He went back to the temple, his place. He asked the master, how can I answer him back? How can I question him back? Then the master said, okay, next day you meet him. When he says, I am going to the area where the wind is blowing, to that direction I go, you ask him, if the wind is not blowing, to where you are going? Then the second day he met, he asked the same question. The boy said, I am going to the place where my legs are going. Then again he cannot ask him anything back. He went to the master and said, if your legs are not going, where are you going? And then the third day, when he met, the boy asked, where are you going? I'm going to the market to buy vegetables. Unpredictable. You cannot argue with such people. Buddha was such a person. You cannot go with the preconceived conception, ideas, to challenge the Buddha. Because we don't know in what manner Buddha will approach to you. Yeah? And this, Vachayana says that people who come to argue with him from all these, the learned nobles, learned Brahmins, learned householders and learned recluses, they come with these predetermined, pre-planned arguments. But Buddha teaches the Dhamma in such a way, they, instead of having arguments with the Buddha, they even cannot ask a question. Instead of asking questions and arguments, what do? They become his disciples. Yeah. when I saw these four footprints of the Buddha, I understood that the Blessed One is fully enlightened, his Dhamma is well proclaimed, and the Sangha is practicing the good way. He saw this miracle happening day after day, day by day. It is happening. People who come to the arguments, challenging the Buddha, becoming disciples. Yeah? Some becoming monastics, some becoming the permanent followers of the Buddha. Now, when this was heard by Janasoni, he got down from his chariot, put his palms together to the direction of the Buddha, and he said three times, Namo tassa bhagavato varahato samma sambuddhassa. This stanza, repeated three times. Because why? This is a compliment to a religious master by a follower of another religion. This must be a real, authentic compliment. Right? If your friend give a compliment, you can doubt it. But if your enemy gives you a compliment, you can trust it. It is true. That is why he cannot avoid telling it. But if your friend is telling that, he can be, you know, buttering you to... He can say anything. But if a friend, if an enemy tell you something good about you, that must be really good. So this is a person of another religion complimenting the Buddha, Janusoni thought. For this man to be having confidence on the Buddha, Buddha must be really having this confidence, having these qualities. That is why he put his palms together and bowed down to the Buddha. Okay. Then he said, one day, if I have the opportunity, I will go to see the Buddha. Then one day, Janusoni actually went to see the Buddha. When he went to see, it says he did not worship the Buddha, bow down the Buddha, but, you know, had a amiable talk, courtesy about the well-being of each other, and he sat down aside. Remember, this is a Brahmin, very proud people. They are very proud people. They considered the highest caste. So after this amiable pleasantries, Janusoni remembered the incident which happened between him and the Pilotika, and he told the Buddha what the Pilotika told him about the four elephant footprints, four footprints of the Buddha, the comparison. The Buddha said, Bhagavan said, it is not complete. I will teach you the complete version of elephant footprints. Now it is, now only we start the real Dhamma talk. It will take some time. Then Buddha said, he says, suppose an elephant woodsman were to enter an elephant wood. We know now what does he mean by elephant wood. Huh? Otherwise there are no something called wood called elephant wood, like teak, like jackfruit, elephant wood, no such thing. This is a forest, yeah, where the elephants used to be around. Were to enter an elephant wood and were to see an elephant wood, a big elephant's footprint, long in extent, broad across. A wise elephant woodsman would not yet come to the conclusion. Now he saw this big footprint. In the first story he said what? When he saw the footprint, at once he decided this must be a footprint of a big bull elephant. But Buddha says, a wise elephant woodsman would not yet come to the conclusion, indeed this is a big bull elephant. That means he will not decide immediately this must be the footprint of a big bull elephant. Yeah? Why? In an elephant wood, there are small she-elephants that leave big footprints. Yeah, there are small she-elephants. The commentary explains with the big belly, but they are small in stature, but they have very big foots. So naturally, they leave very big footprints. They are smaller in size, but their footprint is very big. So he is not coming to that conclusion quickly. The second one, He follows and sees in the elephant wood a big elephant's footprint, long in extent, broad across, and some scrapings high up. Not only the big footprints are there, but also the some scrappings, some damages happen to the tree on the very high level. That means can come to the conclusion that this must be a really big elephant, that maybe that is the big bull elephant. Yeah, but still he doesn't come to the conclusion. Why? In an elephant wood, there are tall she-elephants that have prominent teeth and leave a big footprint. Yeah. Because of that, he doesn't come to that conclusion quickly. Then again, in the third times, again he saw a big elephant's footprint, long in extent, broad across, and some scrapings high up, marks made by the tusks. Right? Not only damages to the trees, but also, you know, the marks made by the tusks of the elephant. Even then, he is not coming to the conclusion saying that this is a big bull elephant. Yeah? Why? In an elephant wood, there are tall she-elephants that have tusks and leave big footprint. Yeah? So this might be one of their footprints. It is not it may not be the footprint of a king elephant, that is big bull elephant. He follows it further and see in the elephant wood a big elephant's footprint, long in extent and broad across, and some scrapings high up, and marks made by the tusks and broken off branches. These things are there. Then, and he sees that big bull elephant at the root of a tree or in the open, walking about, sitting or lying down. He comes to the conclusion that this is a big bull elephant. Now, Buddha's teaching with this simile is clearly explained. Who is this big bull elephant in his simile? Can you guess? Who is this big bull elephant? Buddha himself. Or in the Dhamma wise, enlightenment. Until you find the enlightenment by yourself, your confidence on the Buddha is not perfect, not correct, not right, not complete. That's the idea. Because still it can be something else. Until you come to the understanding, your personal, your own comprehension with the experience, you should not have, or you do not have the real confidence in the Buddha. The real confidence happened that the Buddha's enlightenment and about his teachings and about his students, the real confidence happened with your own enlightenment. That is the idea. Right? Footprints are the path towards this enlightenment. First, a small one. Second, the elephant. She elephant. She is tall with big feet, but no tusk. The third one, she had even tusk, but still it is not the big bull elephant. The last one, until you find that big bull elephant, no matter whether you find these small elephants or other elephants, your confidence will not be authentic, truthful. Until you attain the Nibbana itself, you will not know who the really Buddha is, what his real authentic teaching is, who the Buddha's followers are. You will not know. That is the meaning. Okay? Now, with that, Buddha tries to explain the path to the enlightenment. Path to the enlightenment step by step, right? Now he says this sutta, I told you this sutta has a kind of a very clear explanation about the path to the enlightenment. Yeah, but I'm not going to get all the things. First he says, Buddha says, if someone comes to listen to me, the Tathagata, if someone comes to listen to the Dhamma of the Tathagata, he teaches the Dhamma, good in the beginning, good in the middle, and good in the end, with the right meaning and phrasing, and he reveals the holy life that is utterly perfect. Okay? Someone comes to. When somebody listens to him like that, what does he think? He think, Sambhadoyam garavaso abbo kaso pabbaccha. Sambhadoyam garavaso. Living in the household is lot of obstacles. Sambhadu, obstacles. Pabbacchaya abbo kaso pabbaccha. Living in the monastic life of a monastic is like the life in the sky, or the sky itself. Buddha compared the monk's life those days, okay? Monk's life compared to the birds in the sky. Only the heaviness, or only burden the birds have is the weight of the feathers, right? Likewise, the monks have what? Monks have the alms bowl on the right shoulder and the rope in the left shoulder. Nothing else. So that only that weight is there with the monks. That means the life of a monk is compared to the life in the sky, very light. You cannot be in the sky with heaviness. When you are light, you can be in the sky. Sambhadoyam garavaso abbukaso pabbaccha. The household life is so much of obstacles. The life of a monk is like the life in the sky. Now when Buddha teaches Dhamma, good in the beginning, middle and end, with all this clarification, the people who listen to it, some of them think that life of the monk is the best one. So they joined the order of the Buddha. Now this is the beginning. Then Buddha says, they take two kinds of precepts. Charitta, Varitta. Varitta. Now you say what? Veramani Samadhyami. Veramani. The precepts which indicate that you should avoid. What are those precepts? Killing. Taking what is not given, lying, stealing, sexual, for the monks, sexual conduct itself, drinking or taking alcoholic things to intoxicated, and not only that, wearing jewels, wearing ungoods, perfumes, watching, entertainments, watching entertainments, enjoying entertainments. All these should be avoided. Virati, veramani, abstain from these. Then after that, you have to charitta. Charitta means you have to observe, you have to take in. What are those things? Simple livelihood. To be happy with whatever you get. To be contented. Yeah. To be wakeful all the time, most of the time, to be wakeful. Not to surrender to the sleep. To know the limit of your food. to know what is the seclusion. All these things must be taken to the life. Now, in several chapters, Buddha explained all these things. Yeah. Then after that, he says how he should conduct himself. He says, this is very important, right? This is the vipassana. He says, on seeing a form with the eye, right? On seeing a form with the eye, he does not grasp at its signs and features. Whether it is beautiful, whether it is nice, or whether it is bad, ugly, he does not grasp the signs and features, right? For him, man is a man, woman is a woman. He does not go for the details. Yeah? Since if he left the eye faculty unguarded, evil, unwholesome states of covetousness, grief might arise in. If he is not aware of it, what happened? He will judge. When he judge, what happened? All the defilements arise. So he practices the way of its restraints. He guards the eye faculty. He undertakes the restraints of the eye faculty. That is how he guards of the eye faculty. Not to go to the details, but to be limited to the form itself. When he hears the sound, he does not decide whether this is a beautiful sound or ugly sound. It is just a sound for him. He stops that level. Whether he tastes something, he does not judge whether it is tasty, whether it is nice or not tasty. This is the way he practices. Yeah? Then he says, when he is walking around, when first he observes the precept, okay? Observe the precept to avoid things. Then he started adopting certain livelihood, certain ways of living which is suitable for the nirvana. This is the livelihood Buddha explains for a person to suit for the nibbana. The first one, he restrains his senses. Restrains in the senses of what? Restrains his senses not to go for the details, but to limit a sound as a sound, a form as a form, a smell as a smell. No details are there. It is just a smell. Good or bad doesn't matter. Yeah? That is how he restrained his senses. Now come to the second one. Buddha says, he is practicing awareness in such a way, going forward and returning, who acts in full awareness when looking ahead and looking away, who acts in full awareness when flexing and extending his limbs. All the physical movements are done with the full awareness. The second step. First, restraining senses. Second, all the physical movements are done with the awareness. None of the movements are happened without his awareness. Then, possessing this aggregate of noble virtue and this noble restraint of the faculties, and possessing the noble mindfulness, first the virtue, precepts, then the restraint of the faculties, the indriyas, restraint, then goes to the mindfulness, noble mindfulness. These three factors, virtues, the restraining of the senses, then goes to the mindfulness. He resorts to a secluded resting place. Now, these are the places Buddha approved for meditation. Yeah, see whether you can find the forest, the root of a tree, a mountain, a ravine, a hillside cave, a charnel ground, that is cemetery, cemetery, one of the places for meditation. A jungle thicket, yeah, an open space, a heap of straw, a heap of straw. Yeah. Now, in the, that person will find such a place. On returning from his arms round after his meal, he sits down, folding his legs crosswise. Now he's saying, folding his legs crosswise, sitting his body erect and establishing mindfulness before him. Where the mindfulness? Before him. Before him means what? Here. At the nostrils. Not something in front. It is at the nostrils. Cross-legged. Sitting straight forward. Sitting straight. Yeah. And establishing mindfulness here. He abides the mind free from covetousness. He purifies his mind from the covetousness. Now, when he is practicing like that, he started purifying his mind from the covetousness. What is the Pali translation for covetousness? Anybody, please? Kama. Kama Chanda. First hindrance of the fire. Kamachanda is from where I get Kamachanda. You know, Kamachanda Vyapada Tinamitta Uddacha Kukucha Vichikicha. From where? Uddacha. Yes, yes, I know the meanings. I'm asking from where I took these things. Kamachanda. This list, five? Hindrances. Five hindrances. Now, when he's practicing like that, the first hindrance will be restrained, removed. That is Kama Chanda, covetousness. Then comes what? Ill will. Kama Chanda, Vyapada. Then comes Thinamidda, sloth and torpor. Then comes the Uddacha Kukkucha, restlessness and remorse, and vichikicca, doubt. Do you know these five hindrances? Pancha Nivarana. Now, when he is practicing like this Pancha Nivarana Dharma, Kamachanda, Vyapada, Thinamidda, Uddacha Kukkucha, Vichikicca, Kamachanda, covetousness, sensual desires, you can say. Vyapada, ill will, Thinamidda, sloth and torpor, Uddacha Kukkucha, restlessness and remorse, yeah, and Vichikicca, doubt, they disperse, they vanish. When these five hindrances are vanishing, another four things actually start rising up. These are the things start rising up. Yeah, jhanas. Pancha Nivarana, the five hindrances must be suppressed, must be discarded even temporarily for the jhanas to arise. First jhana has these factors: vitakka, vichara, piti, sukha, ekagata, sahita, patama jhana. Vitakka, initial application. That means you bring your attention to the nostrils, and bringing this mindfulness to the object of meditation is vitakka. Vichara, hang around this object like a bee hanging on around the flower. Vichara, hanging around the flower. Vichara, right? This is the first two steps of the first jhana. Third one, when you are hanging around, these are the things you can do. When you are practicing, only the things you can do is, now, vitakka is initial application. Initial application in the sense, you sit down, sit up upright, and bring your attention normally to the anapanasati, to the breathing meditation. Bring your attention to here. And
you continuously keep the attention here. That is vichara. Okay? When you are continuously, repeatedly keeping the attention here, and when your focus of this breath, touch of the breath, is becoming sharper and sharper, when you are doing vichara continuously, piti will arise, the zest. Piti is the zest, extreme happiness. Sukha is the physical happiness. Piti is usually for the mental happiness. Sukha is the physical happiness. Physical happiness means your body itself lose the weight of the body, the painful feelings of the body will be lost. Body will be feeling like very light. Right? So the sukha. Then of course ekagrata, concentration. Sahita means all these are contained in the Patamajjhana. So in the Patamajjhana, first absorption of meditation. Yeah? Where people go for miracles, do miracles, flying in the sky, drowning in the earth. They have to have this kind of absorptions. Jhana is absorption. So initial application, sustained application, then comes the mental joy, then comes what? The physical happiness, physical comfort, then of course the concentration, develop concentration there. Sahita means all is contained in the Patamajjhana. First, absorption of meditation. How many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 factors. Related to these 5 factors, related to what? Related to the previous 5 hindrances. When these 5 hindrances are reducing and reducing, these things become stronger and stronger. Do you understand this way? That is how these 5 factors are given in the first jhana. Right? Now, when a person comes to the second jhana, that person, no need to bring the attention to the nostrils, no need to worry about the hanging around the object of meditation. His mind is naturally concentrated. Huh? So these 2 factors are useless in the second jhana. At once, in the second jhana, these 2 factors are not needed. So the second jhana is piti sukha ekagrata sahita dutiya jhana. Dutiya is 2, right? It is dutiya. Right? Then comes the tatiya jhana. Then mental happiness also not so significant anymore. It is not so important anymore. It is not so valued anymore. Because it arises and vanishes. So why we hang on to the something very trivial? Right? So this importance is also born in the third jhana. That is, then what happened third jhana is sukha ekagrata sahita tatiya jhana. Right? Then comes the last one, panchamajjhana, chatutta jhana. In the chatutta jhana, instead of this bodily happy feeling, comes another feeling called upekkha. What is upekkha? Upekkha is kind of equanimity. But remember, this is not the negative attitude or something. It is not a negative attitude or something. It is the understanding of the reality of everything. When you understand the realities, because you saw these are not permanent, they are evanescent, they can vanish anytime. You enjoy such a joy, but that joy is very evanescent, momentary. They are just exist for the moment. So when you experience, naturally you will not be sticking onto the piti and sukha anymore. instead of that, it will arise in you the equanimity, understanding that they are all impermanent. This equanimity will arise, upekkha. So the fourth jhana is upekkha ekaggata sahita chatuttha jhana. Okay. So after that, that person, without stopping at the level of these jhanas, that person will direct his concentrated, his usable concentrated mind will direct to his past lives. If your concentration have developed to such a strong level, he can see countless number of past lives with the details. Not just, okay, I was in my last life, I was born in such a country. Not that only. With all the details, he can see the past lives. That wisdom will arise to that person. That is called Pubbe Nivasa Anusati Jnana. Nivasa, Pubbe means earlier. Nivasati means lives or living. Anusati is memorizing. Memorizing of the former lives. Now that person, you know, about our past lives, it is the belief, right? We never remember our past life. Anybody? me neither. Never. It is a belief for us, right? It is a belief for us. But here, this person, after the chatuttha jhana, after that jhana, he will direct his mind to the past lives and he will remember countless number of past lives if he develop continuously. So this wisdom will arise in him. Pubbe Nivasanusati Jnana, that is the former lives, knowledge on the former lives. Yeah? Memory, anusati is usually memory of the former lives. Then comes the future, chutu upapata jnana, chuti. Chuti is the birth, death, upapata is the birth. The knowledge from the birth and, death and the rebirth. He will see how beings are, how all living beings are dead and getting rebirth according to their karma. Now, for us, the future life also believe. Because Buddha told us we are going to be reborn, so we believe it. But the people who developed this mind, they will see themselves, not only they themselves, but also others. Other beings are being dead and getting rebirth according to their karma in the lower or higher realms. Yeah? That is the next one. Then comes the asavakkha jnana. Asava is the defilements. Kaya is destroyed, the destruction of the defilements. The knowledge on the destruction of the defilements will happen to him. That means what? He will find he himself has no more rebirths, no more reverting back to the samsaric life. His samsaric journey is over. Then he will find that the Buddha is truly enlightened, his Dhamma is really directing to this Nirvana, and his Sangha is on the right or the good path. He will directly see that. Until that, these steps, 1, here 4, 5, 6, 7, these are the footprint of the path of the enlightenment. Until one gets the 8th footprint. Even beyond that, when he sees that he has no more rebirth, his samsaric journey is over, then only he understands that the Buddha is truly enlightened. His confidence is true. Right? And then only he found the big bull elephant. Yeah? Then only find the Buddha. Until then, his saddha, his confidence in the Buddha is not true, not genuine. The real genuine confidence happened here.
This is what the Buddha told to Janusoni, explained to Janusoni. After this explanation, Janusoni was very pleased. He was so happy. He expressed his confidence to the Buddha, and he said, "I go to Master Gautama for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of Bhikkhus. From today, let Master Gautama remember me as a lay follower who has gone to him for refuge for life." He became a lay follower of the Buddha. Okay? That's enough.